Hello and welcome to our NPM Pittsburgh webinar on wedding jitters, yours, not the bride's. I'm David Dreher, your host, and I'm very happy to have a wonderful panel of guests to discuss the kinds of things that you might be interested in and knowing about weddings, and maybe some hot button discussions and topics. So before we get into that, let's introduce some of our panelists. Why don't we start on over here, Ken?
I'm Ken Danchik. I'm the Associate Organist at St. Paul's Cathedral, and I've been doing this for at least 45 years.
I'm Mary Beth Barsh. I'm the Music Director at St. Philip in Crafton and Ascension in Ingram. I've been doing this job for over 20 years.
I'm Amanda Plazek Bruce. I am the Director of Music at St. Mary of the Mount Parish on Mount Washington, and I'm proud to say that I'm the Social Media Editor for NPM National. And I am the youngest here, I'd say, other than Daniel, who you'll meet in a minute. I've only been doing this for 16 years.
Daniel. Hi, I'm Daniel Kovacic. I'm the Minister of Music at St. John Capistran in Upper St. Clair and St. Thomas More in Bethel Park, grouping 221. And I've been doing this for 20 years as well. So I'm looking forward to sharing my experience and listening to everybody else and learning from each other.
Hi, my name's Tom Coyne. I'm at grouping 228, which is St. Maximilian Kolbe in Homestead, St. Teresa of the Zeu in Munhall, Resurrection in West Mifflin, and St. Rita's in Munhall Gardens. I've been doing church music for 37 years.
So as you can see, we have a very large cross-section of experience here. Let me do a little bit of housekeeping before we get started. If you're watching this as we are broadcasting this as our webinar, please know that this is a pre-recorded presentation. However, if you have some questions or some comments that you would like, you can go ahead and put those in the comment section. I'll be monitoring those and hopefully answering those as much as I can. If you happen to be watching this on a delayed basis, you will not be able to ask those kinds of questions. But if you're on our YouTube channel and you're watching this in a delayed time, then please leave your comments below the screen and someone will get back to you on that. Or if you have very specific questions, you can send them to this address that you'll see on the screen here, music@dialpit.org. And our director, Kevin Maurer, will then forward those to me and I'll get them back to you as quickly as we can. So that'll be for any of those comments or questions that are just burning to be answered here. So, Ken, I know that you were part of the original planning of the new ritual and the new rite. I think that was a couple of years ago. What was the idea behind doing some of the new things that we're doing? And maybe you could tell us a couple of things that came out of that meeting in 2016 that are different than what we have been doing 20, 30, 40 years ago.
Sure. Well, the new rite was revised in 2016, and it was supposed to be promulgated everywhere, which means we are all supposed to have done all of this already.
Now, was this just for the United States or
yes,
for the whole
United States? Okay. And there's some very interesting changes in the rite from 1969, and probably the introductory rites were the most often the changes are most often mentioned in the introductory rites. For example, the priest now has the option of meeting the couple at the door, and then having a liturgical procession with parents and bride and groom, and but there's also the other option, which is the more traditional, where there is a bridal procession and the way most people have seen it. But what's interesting now is that the new rite calls for a hymn to be sung during the procession, and if that's not sung, there is a chant that is to be sung. Now, the rite doesn't say who sings it. It doesn't even specify what the text is. You can't get that text in the rite, in the ritual book. You have to go to the missal. And there are three antiphons which can't be chanted, and there's no music for them.
So, here's your option, but you figure it out.
Yes, you have to figure out a psalm tone. And so, you know, who sings that? Is it congregational? It's not really specified.
So when it says chant, though, I know a lot of times with some of the new terminology, that doesn't necessarily mean that it has to be like a Gregorian or rectitono chant. Chant can also mean song, too, right?
Yeah, I'm sure you could set some of these to a through-composed hymn.
Yeah.
You might have to change the text a little bit, but that's what's envisioned, really. And then always the Gloria is sung. And this happens even during Lent and Advent. After the Gloria, then the Mass kind of unfolds the way we're used to. Now, the next change comes during the exchange of vows, and there is an acclamation there, which the assembly is supposed to respond to. The priest says, let us bless the Lord, and the people respond, now and forever, or some other kind of acclamation. And that's kind of a very interesting acclamation to try to make happen.
Yeah, how do you, I mean, if the people haven't, you know, said that acclamation, or maybe they go to two or three weddings over the course of 10 years, how do they know that acclamation?
Well, they don't. So one suggestion is to use the Alleluia, the same Alleluia that was proclaimed under the Gospel. Or my suggestion, and I don't know why nobody does this, is, you know, the priest is supposed to say, let us bless the Lord, and we're supposed to say, now and forever. What if the priest sings, let us bless the Lord forever and ever.
Amen. Oh, there we go.
That's all. You
know? That solves the problem.
It's just too simple.
Yeah. Well, I'd be curious, how many of you are doing Glorias at your weddings? You know?
We at St. Philip, we recite the Gloria. And the reason being that there's we use Mass of Creation for the service part, but there's so many people from different parts of the country, you know, so it for us... The reasoning is it's simpler to just recite it and have the flow of the Mass, you know. Mm-hmm. So,
in St. Mary of the Mount, the honest truth is we observe the Gloria when it is a full Mass, not so much when it is a service, and we also observe the Gloria contingent with the approval of the priest, because sometimes I do have retired clergy that come in and would prefer to either recite it or omit.
I had a bride once that came, and she actually wanted Father Chaponis' Jubilation Mass Gloria, and back at one, a former parish of mine, and I said, okay, that's fine. I mentioned it to the celebrant that day, and immediately he forgot. He went right into the collect. And that's the only thing that she was adamant. She goes, I love that Gloria. Mm-hmm. And I felt bad, and she talked to me afterwards, and I said, I'm sorry it was out of my hands. So that's, but yeah, that, I did have that request once, I can say that.
One of the things we're going to be doing for weddings so that doesn't happen is we our bereavement team does, we do a worship aid, and all the information, history, everything about the deceased goes to the priest. We're going to do this very similar thing with the wedding, with a wedding worship aid. So it'll be in bold print, glory to God, sung, recited. And in my grouping, it's 50-50. It depends on the priest as well.
What about processions? Have you has anybody had experience where you're using like the entire family coming in, or do you split it up where the bridesmaids are coming in by themselves, or do you have father coming in with the couples and the parents?
That's 50-50 in my place too. Father Nick will come in with them. Father Dan is more traditional. But interestingly enough, when you were saying that the rite requires a hymn of some sort to be sung at the beginning, keep in mind, I spent the last 10 years in Homestead, so we bury a lot more than we marry. But the last several weddings that I did, they wanted a song sung as the bride was coming in, which I thought was very interesting. This was the request of the bride herself. You know, I did a wedding last December, and it was definitely non-traditional. I sang a song when the bridal party came in. It was a little, even though that's what the new roles say, it was a little foreign to be doing that, because you're used to like being at the organ, and now I'm at the piano singing a song.
Yes, you know, it's kind of interesting. I think it's great to have the bride and groom coming with parents or godparents, but where are they going to hear that? You know, that's not the thing to spring on them at the wedding rehearsal. You know?
Yeah.
I honestly believe that we need to hear from the pulpit more about celebrating the wedding liturgy, and that's where you put that out there. Oh, you know what? You could have the godparents in the wedding procession and the parents, because then that would percolate in the kind of general atmosphere of people. And you know, maybe someday somebody will go to a wedding and come home and say, you know, the godparents were there, and they'd even ask them to be in the procession.
Yeah.
But you can't spring that at the wedding rehearsal. You know, which brings another point. I wonder if we could have more preaching about the wedding liturgy from the pulpit.
There's probably times in the cycles where readings would lend itself to that.
Yeah, in fact, I've gone through this, the three Sunday cycles, and maybe we can put that up on the website.
We'll have that, yes. We can put that graphic up now. Yeah.
So it would be very interesting to, you know, send an email to your deacons, priests, and say, you know, maybe you should, could you preach about how we worship at weddings? During your homily, maybe not tell jokes this week and preach about weddings. You know?
So wedding feast at Cana would be one when that reading comes up. Mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah, and there's one Sunday where the responsorial song is the wedding song.
It's Psalm 128.
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, there's plenty of
feast of the Holy Family. Yeah.
Well, you know, it would even be very interesting if the musicians wrote the homily.
Oh, there we go.
Send it out to whoever. Just say, you know what? Like when the musician writes the wedding homily. You've seen that?
Yeah.
This is the musician writing the homily.
That's right.
And send, see what you get. Maybe somebody will actually use it.
Well, one of the things we do to piggyback off of that is when the changes to the rite happened, we figured out very quickly that we had to be very transparent with the couples that we were working with, because about 50-50, about 50% of the people that get married at our church are parishioners and about 50% are not. And so we really don't have the sphere of influence to see them every week as much as we would like. And so one of the things that we started doing with parishioner couples first is our pastor, Father Michael, would meet with every couple whenever they got engaged to schedule their, their pre-interview, their marriage interview, and would talk about the changes there. Then I would talk about the changes because I facilitate all the wedding paperwork at our wedding, at our church too. So whenever they would send in their contract and agreement, I would again detail all the changes to the rite in the email. Then when I meet with them to pick their music 4 months in advance, I describe it again. And then whenever our wedding coordinator calls in, they describe it again. So we've said it four times to them.
That's a lot.
Yeah, so when we try and do it, which helps, it helped a lot because then we found that it's not as foreign. And by the time we meet with them.
Well, thinking about all the weddings that we have to do, and you were talking about meeting them 4 months in advance, well, typically, and this is where the jitters part, I think, of this whole seminar comes in, is how do you meet with the couples? When do you meet with the couples? What kinds of things do you talk about? Give us some ideas of how you do that. Tom?
Something that we're going to start in September, which just kind of rolls off of what you were saying, we're going to present three wedding workshops every 4 months. And once a couple has signed their contract, has done their paperwork with the priest, they'll be referred to us, and then we'll meet with them. And at that workshop, we'll have the organist, the associate music director, various cantors, we'll have a violinist, somebody playing the flute, trumpet, and then it'll just be like an a la carte menu. They can pick the music they want, if they want a trumpet, da 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 da. And then, you know, we'll get their scripture readings, so we're going to try to encourage that. So then we'll give them a skeletal worship aid that they can do whatever they want with. We'll email it to them. That way everything is, like, in writing, and then we can just file that away, and then when the wedding gets closer, send them a reminder. I think it's just going to make things a lot easier. I think they do about 50 weddings at St. Therese alone.
That's busy.
Like 45 weddings or something like that.
Yeah. Dan, you're kind of new at a new large parish in the South Hills. How are you going to work that into your whole scheme?
I just looked at St. Thomas More's guidelines, because we have a really nice website, and they have a PDF document to go through everything, not just the musical aspects, but, you know, what you're allowed, not allowed, fees, different things, rehearsal, all that different things. And the one thing it said about the music was, please contact the minister of music a few months before. Well, that's going to change, because obviously the parent is, I'm guessing here, it's probably 6 months or a year or something like that. My policy has always been, as soon as you meet with the priest to go in to sign that, the next person you should see is to call me to make sure it's on my calendar, make sure that I'm available. If not, then, you know, I make sure that it's covered by somebody that would be able to do that. So now it's working off of, you know, how to collaborate with two parishes to make one uniformity, so it's not, well, this is what you do at St. Thomas More, but this is what you do at St. John's. It's more like it's our new parish, and I think that they have to start thinking that they can't start shopping around, even if it's in their own grouping without it. You know, I think that the sense of uniformity is much needed.
Yeah, I didn't think about that. I mean, if you've got more than one parish in your grouping, are they going to be moving around to try and say, well, I like this over here, or I like this person?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, how does that work? Does the pastor say no, all the weddings are going to be in this one particular church, or how does that?
Not at N228. They can pick the church, their choice. As a matter of fact, we have 2 4 o'clock masses, one at St. Max, one at St. Therese. The other two, and I'm not sure how this is going to work out yet, the other two churches are going to be offered for weddings later in the day. That's going to be, you know, an issue because there's only 2 organists there. But, you know, that's something we have to work out. Probably won't happen because there's only about, in the one worship site, there's only about 90 people that attend. And I'm sure, you know, I think most of the weddings will be in St. Therese, to be honest with you. So, but that option is there for them to use any one of the churches.
It's about in 2016 in the West End where I'm from, Holy Innocents and Guardian Angels was closed. So I mean, there were weddings there, but at St. Philip, right now we have about 20 a year, I would say. And we have some people from outside the parish that like the venue, so, you know. But what happens, our priests are wonderful in the sense that the couple meets with the priest first. And then they're filtered down to me, so they contact me, and then I meet with them, I guess about 20 minutes or so, and I have a worksheet for them to fill out. I kind of lost my train here. They could either have their wedding at St. Philip or at Ascension. And Ascension used to be, for those of you that know Pittsburgh pretty well, like a car barn. It was converted about 50 years ago. And it serves the purpose well. The architectures are completely different. But some of our parishioners, our older parishioners, prefer Ascension. But at any rate, I give them a worksheet and the order of service. So scripture, like opening rites, scripture, etc. And I also have like CDs. I could also send them MP3 files. But I have like a list of about 16 pieces they can choose for processionals, hymns, and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So after that, I, you know, have them to look everything over and contact me with their selection. So for our situation, it seems to work pretty well.
Yeah. How about unusual requests for processions or songs? any strange ones that you can think of off the top of your head?
Let's see. I wrote a few down.
Oh, okay.
I just have one, I guess, I want to mention that there was one couple that really wanted Sweet Child of Mine from Guns N' Roses for the Singing of the Mothers.
I'm kind of under a rock. I don't mean to, but
Guns N' Roses. There we go.
And so, for the Singing of the Mothers.
Oh, boy.
And so, my priest has a horrible sense of humor, and so I asked him just for fun about it and just said this couple wants to do this. And he said, I will allow it if the bride walks down to Welcome to the Jungle. That's the only way I'll allow it.
But, good for you.
Yeah. No, obviously we did not.
Oh, God.
But for a sense of humor, you know. But
yeah. Oh, but I've got it all. I've heard it all.
In my younger years, Walk is a song, Walk Like an Egyptian.
Yeah.
They wanted that.
What? Oh, no.
I mean, I was.
Were they going to do the gestures too?
I don't know, but I mean, this was an FBI, foreign born Irish, and he was apoplectic. I thought his head was going to pop off.
Oh, my God.
We have to put that graphic down at the bottom, FBI. That just went by too
foreign
fast.
Foreign born Irish.
I had one, and it was just this past year. It was a very lovely lady, and she had very, very specific tastes. And she goes, I wanted the string quartet, so we got a string quartet. And she goes, and I don't want the organ.
I've heard that many times.
You don't want the organ. This is a brand new church, brand new organ. You don't want the organ. No, I just don't like the sound. I just want strings. He says, well, I'm going to have to play it for the mass parts.
Right.
Can't you do it on the piano? So I finally did acquiesce, and I did it on the piano. But that was because they had the strings and things like that, too. The only other funny thing was, one time I was asked to do this one particular song that I had never heard before. I can't even remember the name of it. But the bride was really insistent on this. So I did some research, and I looked it up. And you know how, like, Barry Manilow years ago wrote that song, Mandy? And it was really about his dog? Okay, I don't know if you knew that or not. Yeah, yeah. So it was this pet dog. So I looked up the history behind this one song, and this was literally talking about a dead pet. And this was dedicated to the pet. And I just drew the line. I said, no, I'm sorry, we can't do that. Well, she got so bent out of shape we had to get another organist to come in, and I got my bench fee for it. But,
wow.
You know, we finally, she says, I just can't work with you. We're going to have somebody else.
I think one of the things that I really find an issue with whenever I have a bride who's unwilling to, like, understand that we have to do sacred music is I hear the line, well, my old church allowed it. That, to me, I've heard many times, and that really bothers me because there's nothing I can do about not following rules in previous churches. Actually, just today, I just got an email from a bride today, and she really wants Jeff Buckley's Hallelujah. Okay, for some reason, this is coming back. I don't know why. It's coming through a phase. But anyway, to piggyback off of that, has a very inappropriate context. Like, it's not anything that I would want at a wedding. But of course, it became popular again when some type of clergy member rewrote it for a wedding and it went viral on social media. But anyways, but yeah, one of the things I really struggle with when replying to people is when they say, well, my old church, this is what she said, my old church allowed Jeff Buckley's Hallelujah. Like, well, first off, is it a Catholic denomination? You know, and if it is, I have no say in, you know, them not following the rules. So,
well, I honestly believe that a lot of Catholics don't see music as prayer. You know, they've never heard that. You know, the reason we have music at Mass is because in our liturgy is because it's prayer. So when they ask some outrageous song, you know, we should say, well, is it prayer? You know, you'll maybe get in trouble with it with a couple of things like the wedding song from Fiddler on the Roof.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, when they ask for something like Knights in White Satin, which is asked of me, I could say, no, that's not a prayer.
My response is always, well, then I want your first bridal dance song to be Ave Maria.
Oh, that's a good one.
I said, so if you want to have this kind of secular thing in the wedding, then you should have Ave Maria as your bridal dance.
That's
they kind of like a whoop.
I was talking to somebody about this. There's a sense, I think, of our young people, a sense of entitlement. Well, I'm getting married. It's my wedding.
Yes.
It's my
yes.
money.
Yes.
This, I want what I want. And what you said about prayer, our kids, they're looking at secular music. And some of the songs that you all have mentioned, I kind of live under a rock, but, you know, there's no sense of the sacred. They don't seem to understand that, and then they get mad. About a year and a half ago, at a visiting couple, you know, that wanted the prayer. And they gave me, you know, but I pushed back and documents and what, you know, so, but the mother, they wanted this like a communion. And so she was going through some kind of cancer surgery. All of this, I brought my emails like as a lesson to me. She says, I'm not feeling it. You know, because she wanted the prayer like after communion.
Yeah.
And she had two cancers. They were young kids. They were CLO. They were great. And I said, and I'm pretty quiet and reserved. I said, you know what? It's just a dumb song.
You know, I found one way to, over the years, having less of those kinds of requests is by giving them a list. Mm-hmm. Now, it's not an all-inclusive list, but, you know, before they come to talk to me or whatever, then they look at that list and say, you know, what's not on there? You know, and I think that maybe will set them thinking, oh, these are all sacred songs. Mm-hmm. You know, You Light Up My Life is not on there, and anything else that, you know, all these other crazy things. So, you know, maybe that would help us out.
Actually, if you bring up an important topic there. So we talked a little bit about what all of us do in terms of, like, how we prepare couples. And that's what I do. So about 4 months in advance, I reach out to a month's worth of couples. So this week I reached out to all of August. And I schedule one-hour meetings with all of them. I do them in groups of 3 and 4 couples, and then I send them a list in advance of suggestions for all of the parts of their wedding that need music. And then I tell them that this is a starting point, and as long as something is sacred, we can talk about it in the meeting. And it really has helped to reduce the guesswork that I think people need. I really think more than anything, they just don't know how to pick Catholic ceremony music.
I also think if you keep the lists short, don't give them as many choices.
Mm-hmm.
Because a lot of the couples that are coming in, like you said, not been to church in a long time, most couples that I deal with honestly can care less, unless they have something specific that they want, they can honestly care less. So if you give them a big long list, it's just going to confuse things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, a lot of things that, like, you know, Amanda, you and Ken, both of you, you're dealing with, you know, parishes that have a high quantity of weddings, and you're dealing with your own pastors doing it. You know their celebratory style, and you deal with, you know, priests that are coming in and such like that too. Your presence may be the strongest presence they have in connection to the church.
I know. Yes.
Because if another priest is coming in, they're doing their paperwork, but yet we're the representatives of the church. We're the ones doing the catechesis. Mm-hmm. And that's where the stress sometimes falls on our shoulder, and that's where the stress comes of where they can get it, because they may not have that guidance at the clergy level, because look what our diocese is going through now. And, mm-hmm. you know, we're in this whirlwind, and let alone that's what it is.
Well, I've also found, too, even if they have, like, a guest, or if they have a priest that's not from the parish, it could just be, you know, Father so-and-so that did their cousin's wedding that, yes, they meet with, but maybe don't have a strong relationship with.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Just wanted to comment one more thing about the list. We have at the cathedral on our website, we have our list published. We also have sound clips, so people can listen and then come to discuss.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of times they have no idea what this music is. And so at least, you know, it gives them a chance to do some research before they come. Because one thing you don't want to do is have to play through everything on your list.
Sometimes twice.
I've done that,
oh my
yeah.
gosh.
Yeah.
It's draining.
And then can I hear that one again?
Can you play number five? Then can you play number two?
No, you can do that at home.
A little bit of five, a little bit of two. It's a buffet.
That's an excellent idea, actually.
Yeah.
Yes.
We've actually gone one step further than that. We've actually got a form stack form so that they can go ahead and fill out a lot of these kinds of things, and that is automatically sent to me and the pastor. So we get those kinds of that information even before they come to me.
That's
sometimes
right.
The ideas change, you know, their selections will change,
right.
But that way they can also pick scriptural readings and maybe alternate music of other kinds.
Right, and same, we're following that track too, that everything will be online, that they'll have sound clips and everything. So.
Yeah.
Can I ask one question about that, though? You just said picking readings. Can I ask the table, what do you give your couples for wedding liturgy guidelines? Like, we use the Together for Life book from Ave Maria Press.
Mm-hmm.
Is that what you use, too?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. I just always wondered that.
So what we did was we took the readings and then we put them in a tabulated form so that they can mm-hmm. click onto each one and then read it. And if they want to use that, then they click onto that and it gets populated into the stack. Well, thinking about some of these musical selections, like for psalms or for communion songs, you know, obviously we need someone to sing. If we're not singing from the keyboard, and if you have a cantor, that is certainly a plus. How do you go about getting a cantor, or how do you choose a cantor, or do the couples request a cantor, or do they come in and say, hey, I've got Aunt Susie who used to sing, you know, and can she sing? How do you handle those kinds of things? That can be very stressful.
Okay,
all right, that's not like a
well, I'm going away in 2 days, and Easter Monday I receive a phone call on my thing, and it's like, oh, you know, somebody needs something, and it was a guy that calls me on the phone. There's a wedding coming up at the church in June. The couple has not contacted me, but the guy who is cantering is calling me on the phone to tell him that I would like to go and give you the music that we are doing.
Oh,
you're going to do that with me. You all know who I am. Okay. But I thought to myself, I stepped back and I said, I'm just going to let this go. I have to let it sit for a day. Because if I call him back, you know, raw emotions can hit. It's like hitting the email after, you know, that. So I sat back and I thought, he shouldn't be calling me. The bride should be calling me. The groom should be calling me. Both of them should be calling. That's who should be contacting, not a guest musician. So I got the number from the bride and I told her, I said, here's our parish policies. I said, I understand that he's a friend of yours. I don't know him. I said, he could be the best musician in the world. He could be better than Pavarotti himself. But yet he's not a minister of the church. And our policy is that a parish cantor who is trained in liturgical guidance that knows the liturgy is good. However, if you would like to have your friend to sing, we have special places. Do you have flowers to the Blessed Mother? Great,
yes,
you can sing Ave Maria. You can lead the communion hymn. You can sing something at the offertory. I'm not discouraging that. However, it's the thing is that I'm, in a sense, it's like the parish has its own mission to make sure that the sacrament is celebrated properly. You know, I'm sure everybody here has had the cousin from Savannah, Georgia that comes in, that they come in the night before and they say, hey, I want to sing the wedding. They show up the week before. Oh, I forgot my music. I didn't have time to practice. And that hour before, and yet, are they Catholic?
Or can you teach me the song?
Yeah. And the thing is, can you teach me the song? But when do I bow? Where do I go? Those are not logistical questions that should be happening beforehand. I said, that's why the couple has the practice beforehand to go up the aisle, down the aisle, where to sit and everything like that. Music's a different thing because the thing is that everybody's a critic when it comes to music now. TV can show. We have American Idol. We have America's Got Talent. And if something goes wrong, who gets blamed? All of us around the table, you know?
Yeah.
So that's, I think, that's a very touchy subject with that. Yeah, that's neat that you said that because that's fresh off the table with that.
That's something that I need to develop on my wedding thing. I usually canter the weddings. I charge $175 to play a wedding, and we're asking $100 for the canter. And a lot of these couples don't seem to want that because that's an extra expense. Meanwhile, they're spending thousands of dollars for everything.
The reception and flowers and everything else.
Exactly. So that's, Daniel, even with, like for funerals too, that's off the topic here, but correct. I mean, you know, but I'm blessed to have a number of choir people who function as cantors, so that's no problem. But I think the asking the $100 is prohibitive to some of these couples. So that's one area where I feel I need to develop as a musician. But having a cantor is, I think, vital to try to get these folks to participate because, you know, they're just down
True.
There, you know.
See, I tend to be a little cynical on that because, so I'm kind of a combination of both of you. Because of how many weddings we have, I sing and play probably about half of them, and
sure.
we require that whether I sing or a cantor sings, they pay the cantor fee. So I get the cantor fee if I sing and play.
Are you downstairs?
I am downstairs.
See, because I'm upstairs. That's
yeah,
different.
I'm downstairs. But even then, of the other half, I have four of my cantors that are very highly trained, and
mm-hmm.
they're the cantors. But when a family member, when a bride comes to me and says, oh, I have my cousin Jamie, she really wants to sing the Ave Maria, if they want to sing the entire wedding, even if it's not a full mass, I require that they are a regularly scheduled cantor at a Catholic church right now. Not 20 years ago, which I also got burned on once, but right now. Quite often I will ask for the church and I will call and verify. If I really get a very strange vibe from the vocalist, that maybe they really aren't like, oh, well, they used to sing or they sing once every 6 months, I still verify. And then even if at that point, they are a Catholic church cantor and they're singing the whole thing, I still rehearse with them in advance and I schedule a 1-hour rehearsal with me and that vocalist and I charge extra. So
you almost have to though. I mean
yeah.
you can't throw the fish in the cold water like that, expect to survive, you know.
Well, I always tell a couple that I say, well, I have to charge a rehearsal fee, but you know what, this is also that everything we're doing right now so that everything goes smoothly on the day.
Exactly.
And that's what I tell them. I say, I want your vocalist, I want your cousin, I want your whomever to feel so comfortable because we've never worked together before. And I want them to walk in, not on the morning of and feel panicked, but I want them to walk in and say, okay, I feel okay.
Where I am right now, we have 4 cantors. We have 18 cantors, 15 of them sing well. I'll leave it at that. We have 4 that are very accomplished. 1 male and 3 female, but I was a voice major, so I'm actually, it's 5 of us. So they're the only ones that I'm going to promote at the wedding workshop, unless somebody wants a cantor of their choice, and they could say, oh, we want the lady that sings and blah, 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 because I think we have to hold really high standards for weddings too, because that's our name is on that, because you're right, if the singer is awful, they're going to be looking at the person who's in charge of the music, like, wow, why did they let that happen?
Another area of stress that we probably have all had to deal with is having other musicians coming in to play or being asked to go other places to play. I mean, how do you deal with those kinds of things? Are there policies in place, or do you yourself have to go out earlier and stress about how to turn things on, or have you had any of those experiences?
Duquesne University. After the organ was rebuilt, new organ, everything's in German. I went into the rehearsal and I was like, I don't know what to do. And they said, well, that's going to be $75 for the, I said, I don't care, I'll write the check right now. I said, get him in here. I said, because I'm like, there's no way. I said, I'm like, no spreken English.
This little Irish boy doesn't speak German.
And I was singing. So, I mean, the stress of trying to figure out what all these things mean and playing and singing, I was like, nah, there's not enough Ritalin. There's not enough. Xanax.
We could always have some wine for that.
But Tom, the console at Duquesne University in particular is very unique now because it was modeled, tell me if I'm wrong, modeled under the style of Tremier. So it's called the French Terrace, is that the right?
Yeah.
It's the Terrace Console. So, but that means, though, that the stops are not in the typical place, I think, that you'd think. They go across horizontal versus vertical.
Yes. Oh.
And so it is very confusing when you first get there.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
We have a bench fee in place for, you know, if a guest organist comes in, because, you know, I understand if they're trained, I have no problem, you know, if they have that background in Catholic liturgy. But as you know, it's like, Tom, you have the situation, you went, it's like, here, look at this console, you know. You go to, like, for example, the console of St. Thomas More, it's a form manual. Some people have never seen that, what goes to what. And it's a Walker console, and Walker consoles have locks on them, and they have a four-digit code that you cannot, so somebody cannot go into my memory bank and change all my pistons. It's a wonderful thing, you know? But I
have, my Allen is like
but
that
the
too.
Thing is, we also have a guest account, so if somebody comes in, all they have to do is hit the general cancel. But the thing is, if you're not familiar with that console, and especially that technology, how do you come in and know what's going on? So, you know, the bench fee is not just, hey, I'm not playing your wedding, so you're going to pay me to do it. We still have to work, and we still have to approve. We still have to contact. We have to make sure that organist or that cantor or something has to come in and have the time to show them how things work. Because if that doesn't, that's a poor reflection on us as ministers of saying, well, we don't care. You know what I mean? And with things like that as well.
Going to other places where you don't know if everything's going to be set up or things are going to be hidden, it's just... I rarely go out to do weddings outside, but I'm going to tell you what. I take my lightest keyboard and put it in my car, and I have a microphone stand, mic cords, and cables, just in case, because, you know, you end up in a place, and you're like 40 minutes from home, and all of a sudden there's nothing there, whereas you can just plug all this
stuff. There's no Radio Shacks anymore. You can't just run down the street.
No, you're right.
Actually, Tom, I have a similar story. One time, the one time I've ever done a cocktail hour for a bride and groom, it was a couple that I just so grew to love. They were so into the liturgy. Like, they just got it. You know, you ever get a couple that just gets it? It's so rare, but they got it. And we really bonded throughout the whole 18 months. And so they said, can you come and play... cocktail hour, like, we'll pay you plus your mass sub fee, like, we just really want you to be a part of it. I'm like, oh, that's really sweet, sure. And I got married, and my reception was at Duquesne University's ballroom, and they had a baby grand piano there. And so I so foolishly thought the Wyndham downtown still had their piano there. So I show up to play cocktail hour, and there was no instrument.
Oh my goodness. I know.
So,
I would have fainted.
Oh,
no. I would have fainted right in the lobby.
Oh, my.
I know. So what did you do?
So,
she pulled out her kazoo, and then she played Spain on a kazoo.
I called all of my friends and my colleagues, and I found someone to bring me a keyboard, and I didn't even have a stand for it. We put it on, like, a high table.
Honey. Wow.
Oh, good for you. It worked. It still worked.
It was. Yeah.
That's
it,
right.
You it worked barely. I mean,
talk about stress.
Barely.
Oh, but
oh man.
You never do it again.
I'm getting
situation.
High. So
that was, yes.
If nothing, church musicians are resilient.
Yeah.
And we have to be.
Flexible. Yeah.
It's one of the things we've done is we have a handbook that we actually give the couple, and it talks about photography, it talks about flowers, it talks about the music and selections, it talks about the rehearsals and those kinds of things, so that it's laid out pretty clearly about what our expectations are and what our services are going to be. So do any of you have those kinds of things?
Yeah, we do. We have a wedding policy agreement that every bride and groom must read through and initial at the bottom of each page, and that's right when they get engaged. But I think one of the things that has helped us is I stopped calling my fee a bench fee and started calling it a music coordinator's fee. So that if I wasn't playing, I was still, like you said, like, I still meet with the couple to pick their music. I still reach out to all their instrumentalists to make sure I coordinate, you know, setup times. I'm still there on the day of the wedding to do a sound check,
right,
to make sure they
absolutely
don't, they don't need photocopies. And I'm still there all during prelude and make sure they don't need anything. And then I go over to my office and then I come up afterwards and then help them clean up. So I called it a music coordinator fee, and I think it's kind of helped people to see that I'm still present, but I'm just kind of like in the background.
It's actually a nicer way of putting it too, because you're extending yourself. Bench fee is,
yes,
like, okay, pay this fee, you won't see me. But you're, you
right,
know.
Right.
This sounds like it might be a bridezilla kind of a thing. Was this one of those kinds of weddings?
Yes.
How bad was it?
Met initially like 2 months ago, or started the ball rolling 2 months ago, and started organizing. Actually, as far as the music went, she was very, very easygoing, except she wanted to bring a cousin in that was a trumpet player, so she told me. So Holy Week, I started getting text, calls, you know. I could understand why a trumpeter worth his weight in anything did not have trumpet voluntary, or hornpipe, which actually scared me because, you know, I talked with the family that Monday, and, you know, the bishop was so gracious to schedule confirmation on Thursday after Easter, so, you know, stress for a new group of people together. So I finally said to her, this music, you can download a PDF for free. I said, is this guy a trumpeter for real? And she goes, well, actually, he's a trombone player. So my first response, which was Nina's also, why don't you find trombone voluntary? So she asked me if I could write this music out, and I said yes, and she said, will you? I said, no. I said, I have confirmation in 3 days,
yes,
and I have 5 rehearsals because our choir had gone helter-skelter. I piecemeal everything together, and working with the kids, I said, I have no time to sit down to do this. So Nina saved the day. She came in, she played, because she can transpose anything off the top of her head. I can't transpose and do things like that and sing. And so it ended up working out. And in the end, she ended up paying us more than what we had expected.
Any other bridezilla stories?
No, I don't
want to
tell them.
A groomzilla.
I have a groomzilla
too, actually.
Everybody complains about the bride, but they're just as, bad sometimes. Imagine that. But no, it was actually probably about 10 years ago or more at my home parish. When I was younger, 5 years into my ministry, I knew her family grew up. She owned a dairy out in Fayette County, and the groom was just the exact opposite of her. And I hate to say this, but I'm sure there are couples that you look at and say, I wonder if they're going to be together in 5 years.
Or 5 weeks.
Yeah,
really.
And I thought them, and I hate to say, I thought about them, and unfortunately they're not together at this time. But the guy comes in dressed like he looked like Tupac, okay, and he was very far from Tupac. He couldn't pull the swag. Okay?
Tupac,
the rapper, dead rapper.
He's a dead rapper now.
Yeah. So he comes in into the church, and as you know, like a church, a government building, you don't wear a hat just out of respect of the building that it is. And he walks in, "What's up, man? How you doing?" Blah, blah. I'm like, nice to meet you. Can you take your hat off? No, this is my SIG. And he argued with me for 15 minutes. About this hat, I said, take your hat off, or I will not be meeting with you today. He took his hat off, he pouted the entire time. So I met with the bride, she's super nice, super sweet as can be. We went through the whole entire thing. We got to the recessional. This is back when we were allowed to do the Mendelssohn wedding march, okay, before the stamps of make sure you don't do it anymore. He comes in and goes, can you put a little bit of Janet Jackson, some piece with that? And I said, what are you talking about? So I felt like a DJ at that point. Like, I'm mixing this and mixing that. I'm at the club instead of the church, you know? Wrong C word. So I said, what are you talking about? And he said, this piece, he goes to the piano. It's one of those people that just, they try. And they're sitting here and playing, and you're just, are you done yet? Is the torture over? Purgatory is done. Thank you. Thanks for your God. And so he's playing, and I said, I don't know if I can do that. And he was adamant. He was quiet the entire time. But this was, and I said, fine, I'll do it. Guess what happens when the wedding came? I didn't do it. Because I didn't know what the song, but he was just, and guess what? They knew nothing about it. He just wanted his last thing. And that was it. I mean, but yeah, it was a groom that was just, it was like he wanted this like little DJ moment right there and at the end of his wedding there. And I thought, okay. I don't know if anybody else has had a little mixer story of this piece and that piece mesh them up a little bit. No. Can you mix Jesu Joy and Canon in D? One's in G, one's in D. They're closely related keys by one sharp.
You said you had a Grimzilla.
I do. I have two, and I'm trying to decide which one to say. All right, I'll do this one. So there was a groom that every time I called the bride, the groom would call me back, and that's fine. I mean, sometimes their schedules are just strange. But then every time when I met with this couple, every time I would say, I don't remember her name, let's just call her Laura. Every time I would meet with this couple, I said, well, Laura, what do you want to walk down the aisle to? The groom would reply and say, she wants to walk down to this. And I said, okay, well, why don't I just ask her? I mean, Laura, is that what you want? And he goes, yeah, that's what she wants. And it was the weirdest vibe. And it was like that the whole time. Wow. And I said, okay, so like, what are you thinking for prelude music? And the groom was very into classical music. And he said, I wanted to talk with you about that. I was hoping that you would learn all of Bach's Goldberg variations for the piano, for prelude.
Sure.
And I'm like, no.
$10,000, please.
No, yeah, a lot of money. I said, no. And so then, anyway, so then he wanted, then for recessional, he wanted me to arrange a transcription by myself of the overture from the Marriage of Figaro by Mozart.
Wow.
And you know what? I gave them the note. Maybe I shouldn't say it's my webinar, but I'm about to. I said, well, I mean, first off, it will take hours for me to sit down, listen to it, reduce some type of organ score, and then learn it and practice it. So I gave them a huge number, and they said, yes, so I did it. I mean, here's the thing. It was kind of borderline, but you know what? It was a way to compromise because they also had a lot of secular songs they wanted that were very secular. And so it was my way of compromising with them. If that was like the worst, per se, that was the most borderline secular sacred that they had in their wedding, that was fine. And plus, I did not play the Goldberg variations.
How about repertoire? I know a lot of times, you know, those of us that have been doing weddings for many, many years, you kind of have what might be a set repertoire. And I know a lot of couples, that's all they know is kind of what they've heard. How often do you refresh your own repertoire, and how do you do it?
Yeah, I like to look at other parishes are offering. I think even for Sunday repertoire, I think we need to be in the mainstream. Whenever you're not in the mainstream, you have to have a very good reason for that. And so, you know, one of the places I'd like to look is to see what John Ramirez is doing. Mm-hmm. In fact, he has on his website at the Christ Cathedral a wonderful wedding page, and he posts all the hymns. And when I look at the wedding music that he is advertising, I think, well, maybe we should do something like that.
We'll have that website right there at the bottom of the screen here, so that if you would like to take a look at that listing, and it might give you some ideas of how you might want to formulate some of your own materials that you give to brides and grooms for that. But yeah, I've seen John Ramirez. And for those of you that are not in our diocese, John Ramirez was one of our founding members of early days of NPM, and is now at Christ Church. So we look forward to seeing some more of those kinds of things.
You know, while we're speaking about that, the diocese has this music for the wedding ritual, which is in published format. It's also on the NPM site. So
NPM Pittsburgh site.
Yeah, NPM Pittsburgh site. You can download it and take a look at that.
NPMPGH.org.
Lots of good suggestions there.
Yeah.
A lot of times we're talking about the brides and the grooms and the families and stuff like that, but I think we forget that this is supposed to be a liturgical celebration, that the entire assembly is not just sitting there like bumps on logs, but that they need to participate and that they need to be part of this whole liturgy. What ways can you encourage them? I mean, do you have hymnals or worship aids, or what kinds of things do you use to help the people that are in the pews to participate and sing?
You know, I was just on the phone with LTP a couple weeks ago, because LTP has this worship aid that's permanent. It's really, it's on thick, like laminated, almost cardstock for funerals. And it's meant to be, it's a trifle pamphlet. Kind of like, they remind me of whenever the words for the Roman Missal changed in 2010, and we all bought a lot of like trifled inserts for people to relearn the words. That's what they were, except it's for funerals. And so I was on the phone with LTP, and I said, oh, if you would make one for full mass weddings and non-full mass weddings, that were these permanent trifold worship aids that we could hand out as an accompaniment to a bride's program that she wants to make. I said, oh, we would buy them the day that you would make them. And LTP said, wow, that's a really good suggestion. We'll pass that along. So I think something like that would be good. I've been working on a permanent worship aid for weddings. It's just such a pain in the butt because they opt out of different things, or the priest decides to opt out of something else. So it's a pain.
We don't use hymnals. We have worship aids for everything. So because I have one license.net, and I you can have so much repertoire at your fingertips if you have that license. So I print a worship aid for everything, including weddings too. And so I'll ask the brides to, or the couples, I should say, just to provide the paper. And then I print everything because I have all the templates on my computer to do that, and then I can print them on my Beast machine, and it folds them and does all that stuff. But that way, then, we can incorporate the hymns, we can incorporate the psalms, we can do all those kinds of things, and have that in the worship aid so that people at least can see that there's music there. Oh, maybe I should be singing this.
So I saw a funny program which transitions, at least I think, to another really funny topic. Have you ever seen really funny spelling or grammar errors in your programs? One that it never ceases to make me laugh is whenever a couple in their program describes that after the homily they will have an exchange of vowels. It's my favorite one. Every time I see it, I just love it.
At least they used V and not B.
That's true.
Do you guys use hymnals, or how do you do that with your weddings?
Yeah, we have, St. Thomas More has the worship for hymnal there, and we're going to be updating the hymnal at St. John's. They have the Gather Comprehensive too, but it doesn't have the new mass, you know, translations and such in it. So what we're going to do is we're going to add a supplement in the back as well with some different hymn texts and hymns. So what Worship 4 doesn't have, you know, on the more contemporary side and stuff, we can go and add that as well too, looking at different celebrations as well. So that's what we're going to look at.
In St. Therese, we have Gather Comprehensive 3, third edition. And then in the other three churches, we had Breaking Bread, but we switched over to one license because it was... because it was going to be ridiculous. Like the churches that had very low attendance, they were like 500 hymnals in one church, and they were like 550 a hymnal or something. So when we did the cost of it, it was just less expensive to do a worship aid. Mm-hmm. So we use the same psalm in all four churches, and like the same entrance and closing, and then I give liberty to my associate, anybody else, if they want to add something in there. But they all go out, the worship aids go out. And for weddings, Bridezilla, when I asked her about a worship aid, she goes, I can't be bothered. But I'll tell you what, if I had moved that keyboard stand 1 inch in, I probably would have got a beating.
Well, I'm sure there's a lot of crazy things that happen at weddings, and I don't know if any of you have any stories you want to share about any goofy things that have happened at weddings, you know.
St. Vincent's. The matron of honor passed out, and the best man thought it was hilarious. And then the groom passed out. It was so hot in there.
Oh my gosh!
So they got them hydrated, and then the bride passed out.
What?
It was unbelievable. I was sitting over there. I didn't know what. And finally, about 15 minutes later, the best man passed out, and I wanted to stand up and go like, yes. It was so hot in there. I was soaking wet.
Oh,
and it was just like, poof.
I'm sure you've got some stories.
I do. I have two, actually, but one actually is very similar to that. So we had a wedding last August, and the bride and all of her family was from England. And so I say that for a reason. So during all the Eucharistic prayers, I think, and it was an out-of-town priest, and the priest decided that he wanted to have the couple kneel in this non-air-conditioned church the entire time. So during the and he was also very slow in all of his speech. It was like, "Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world." So it was very slow.
How many Valium did he have before that?
It was very slow. So then I just hear a thud and a scream, and the matron of honor had fallen backwards.
Oh my gosh.
And she hit her head on the back steps. It's like, if you've ever been to St. Mary the Mount, yes. There are a couple of steps coming up to the altar. And the priest, I guess, wasn't used to this. We at St. Mary the Mount probably have two people at least that pass out a year at some event, just because we have no air conditioning. So we actually, strangely enough, have like a protocol in place. So he was not used to this, and so his arms were outstretched during the prayer, the Eucharistic prayer, and all he did was go like this and stand there, and he did not attend to the passed out person. So my wedding coordinator and I ran to her. We took care of her. I mentioned that she's British because she didn't have health care. Well, I mean, she did, but not in the United States. So she didn't want to go to the ambulance. It was a big thing. And so finally, I checked on the bride and groom, who were very shaken up because it was her sister after all. And I said, do I have your permission? Can we continue? And she said, yes, yes. And I said, are you guys okay? Do you feel faint? She said, I actually did right as my sister passed out. And I said, what spirit went through here? And she said, I don't know. So I walk up to the ambo and I say to everyone who's just sitting in shock, and I said, hi everyone. Obviously this was a shock and this was upsetting, but I want to let you know that the maid of honor is okay. She is going to be taken away by the paramedics because she wants to be checked out. So if you hear like sirens or something, don't worry. They're just escorting her out. And I talked to the bride and groom, and with their permission, we are going to continue with the mass. Thank you so much. If anyone else feels faint, we have water. And it's at this point I realized that the priest had never moved throughout this whole thing. And so he stood there like this, and I turned to him and I say, Father, would you like to continue? And he went, bring us to full
assurance. Like and he was on pause.
He was on pause. And I thought, like, what in the, like, who does not react? So anyway. So that's better. And then, okay, last one in this shorter. So up in Mount Washington, we have an issue where when newscasters sometimes come up to do B-roll or to telecast up there, sometimes our frequencies on our wireless mics get crossed. And so there was one time during a wedding where it was during the doxology, and Father Walt, who was my priest there at the time, was raising the chalice and the body and blood, and he goes through him, with him, and in him, and then we hear a crackle across the sound system. And we hear, are you at the car? Yes, I'm at the van. Yes, I have to. It gets better. It's a newscaster. He goes, I have to wait for these effing people. And I mean, just all of my blood comes out of me at this point. And so I run over to
the
sound system.
That's when you start playing the Lamb of God, right?
It just shut off the whole sound system because I didn't know what to do. So I hit the off button, and my poor priest is still standing there, and he goes, forever and ever. Like,
what
do you have to do? So
it was
horrible.
Oh, God.
I know.
Oh, that's good. Well, I want to thank you all for tuning in. This has been a wonderful discussion, and I hope you've learned some things. I hope you get some food for thought. Hope we hit some of your hot topic buttons. And if you would like to share this, don't forget to go to our NPM Pittsburgh website. It's npmpgh.org, and hopefully we'll be able to see you soon. Thank you all for everybody on our panel, and we hope you have a good day.
Thank you.